Since the dawn of time, governments and drug mafias across the world have been at war with each other. But quite recently, a new form of drug abuse has come into existence, something my worthy opponents so voraciously advocate in support of, the nootropic drug abuse. Respected judges, fellow medicos, my worthy opponents, a very good morning to all. Topic on the floor, is it ethical to allow nootropic drug usage and availability without prescription? Call it fate or coincidence, the word no already appears in the word nootropic. I am Mohammed Misbahuddin, a first-year medical student at the Deccan College of Medical Sciences, and I vehemently oppose the motion and state that availability and usage of nootropic drugs should only be allowed under prescription. The advent of nootropic drugs was considered as a revolution in the world of medicine and healthcare. Reason? Because now, treatment of certain critical and chronic diseases, such as schizophrenia, Alzheimer's, ADHD, was now possible. But as history has witnessed time and time again, just the way nuclear energy came in with huge promises of unlimited energy and welfare, but only gave us Hiroshima and Nagasaki, nootropics too have been accompanied by a long list of misuse and abuse. My first argument thus is the inefficiency and ill effects of nootropic drugs over long duration of time. My worthy opponents here seem to have become good ambassadors of pharmaceutical companies, where they sell us this dream drug agenda, where they claim it causes memory enhancement, mood elevation, cognition, alertness, etc., etc. But let me break the hype for you. Dr. Barry Gordon, the director of Cognitive Neuropsychological Department at Johns Hopkins University, states, there is absolutely no strong evidence to support the statement that nootropic drugs cause any cause of memory enhancement in normal individuals. In fact, he states that neither is it clear if it's safe nor if it works at all. He in fact seems to be skeptical about the basic premise of nootropic drugs. The amusing part is he notes that people who claim to have an increased memory enhancement, increased memory power after taking these drugs, are basically because they are under the influence of an effect that we all know as a placebo effect. If you think you can do it better after taking a drug, you will do better. It's as simple as that. Secondly, for the ill effects of these drugs, Dr. Chris D. Adamo of the University of Maryland claims that these nootropic drugs are basically stimulants that are used in the treatment of ADHD diseases. Although these work in patients who are suffering from ADHD, they have absolutely no effect on a normal person who tries to take these drugs to increase focus and attention. College students like ourselves buy these drugs from illegal sources, and we may experience some benefit in the initial stages, but in the long run, it has quite detrimental effects, like blurry vision, insomnia, high heart rate, increased blood pressure, and the worst of all, addiction. He states that people tend to become tolerant to these diseases, to these drugs, and thus need increased dosage with time, and thus become addicted. My second argument is the blooming of black market and the supervision of these of dosages of these drugs. The increasing demand of these drugs and the current situation of law tends to create this situation where supply arises from the black market. So a key benefit of legalizing these drugs under prescription would be that people will be able to buy these drugs for treatment from legalized and legitimate sources rather than going to illegitimate sources like friends and internet, etc., which can easily cheat them. Thus, people now are well aware of what they're buying and what medication they're actually taking, which is totally in favor of them. Lastly, opening doors to these nootropic drugs by making them legal and under prescription will open new doors for research and investment. Therefore, jotting down my arguments, I would conclude my speech by reiterating my stand loud and clear that availability and usage of these drugs should be allowed only and only under prescription. Thank you.
Your opponents say that non-prescription availability is a good thing. I suppose they mean that some individuals may need an upper and wouldn't want to go to a doctor for it. I'm asking you to argue for your opponents in answering my question. Is there any role at all for these drugs to be picked up by, let's say, a mature adult person just to improve their performance on a short term by their own judgment without having to depend on a doctor's judgment for it?
I think it's always wise to trust a doctor's judgment over oneself, because a doctor is the one who has learned and who is a professional and experienced person in this regard. And doctors do have this code of secrecy where they do not share the details of their own patients with anyone else. So I think there is nothing to be worried of for anyone in approaching a doctor, even if it's a short-term problem.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll put it this way. You have 5 minutes with the doctor, generally, that's the average time. You spend a lifetime with yourself. You go to the doctor, you know your problem. You study hard, you have the brains, but you're not able to get the point given in the books. You need something to boost you, you go to the doctor has no time for you, he's in a hurry to see the next patient. You know exactly what you're going through, you know you have to do the next exam well or you're gone. And you come back home and you have no, that's the best doctor in town, huh? Don't get me wrong. What do you do?
Sir, I think I'll still stick with my own self. Okay. I think I'll do better without those drugs, because even though I might gain some advantages, I might do well on my next exam if I take those drugs, but in the long run, it will destroy me.
You're a brilliant guy. You score very well in all the quizzes, debates and all that, but studies you're not so keen. You know, the jargon and the vocabulary, you can't make sense of it. You're brilliant, mind you, but you're not getting that particular point. So you need something. It is legal. Maybe unethical. It's legal. The doctor is not giving it to you. You have the next exam to pass. Your entire future depends on it. You have one day to go. What do you do?
I will approach my elders. My elders will advise me against it.
That is non-prescription, no?
Yes.
Against it? Oh, you want approval of your...
No, I won't take it anyways.
You won't take it anyways.
I won't take it anyways.
But again, give some examples. You said two things. You have cardiac adverse effects and you have addiction potential. Can you name some examples?
Of cardiac problems?
Yes. That's very important, no? See, if I'm not taking a drug, I'm not taking it for a specific reason.
Okay.
That I might be hurt. I need to know what hurts me.
The main problems, I believe, are firstly addiction. Secondly,
examples.
Examples, okay.
Well, I'm sorry, do you want to ask something? Okay, that's okay. Very good, you did well.
The black market.
Yes.
You said that by making these available by prescription will reduce their use in the black market. But don't you think prescription will only be given to the people who the doctor thinks needed? And if other
people... Can you...
Okay. Don't you think prescription of these drugs will be advised only to those people that the doctor thinks needs it? But what about the other people who think they need it, are not being prescribed by the doctors? Will they not turn to the black market and actually aggravate it further?
They're not being given by the doctor because they should not be given. They should not be taking those medicines. That is exactly why the doctor is not giving them. They will try to turn to the black market. That's what normally happens. So if we make them under prescription, and what I said is a few steps that we should take to curb this supply of these drugs from the black market. So of course there will be other policies from the government and stricter regulations and curbing these activities using the police and forces by the government policies and stuff.
Has that been able to stop black market availability of any other drugs?
It's a huge issue. You can't say that not a single person will get these drugs from the black market.
Exactly why you cannot say by making them prescription available you will abolish the black market for these drugs.
No, abolishing, I never said abolishing, I said controlling. There's a difference. You cannot abolish something because it's a huge thing.
Exactly.
For example, poverty, you can't abolish it. You can reduce it, you can control it, but you cannot abolish it completely at all. So black market is a similar thing. By government policies and stuff, we can control it, we can bring it down by increasing prescription drugs. That will in many ways curb black market.
Thank you.